Hello and Namaste. I began this temple series with the story of Srirangam, where I talked about an ancient temple for Ganesha called Uchipullayar Koil, situated on a hill in Trichy. This hill is called Rockfort and it is home to several ancient cave temples. Today I want to talk to you about the oldest temple on this hill, a temple for Shiva built by the Pallava king Mahendravarman. Not many people visit it or even notice it, maybe because it is no longer in active worship. It is among the earliest cave temples of South India, a 1500-year-old temple built in 600 AD. The giant rock from which the temple has been carved is more than 3.8 billion years old, which makes it older than the Himalayas. It has a magnificent sculpture of Shiva as Gangadhara. It depicts the instant when Shiva captures Ganga in his matted locks as she descends from the heavens. Here, Ganga is represented as a young girl, her hands folded in Anjali Mudra as she lands on Shiva's unfurled lock of hair. What makes this cave temple special are the inscriptions on its walls. They are written in the script called Pallava Grantha. It was invented by the Pallavas and used in the Tamil country to write Sanskrit. The script for many languages of East Asia like Java, Sumatra, Thai, Laos, Khmer, Cambodia, Vietnam and many more originated from Pallava Grantha. The most fascinating of these inscriptions are the ones on either side of Gangadhara. It is a series of Sanskrit couplets composed by the king himself. King Mahendravarman was a polymath. He was talented in many fields. He was a political genius. He was the first to build cave temples in the south. He has authored several plays. He was a great painter and a poet. His mastery over poetry is reflected in the 8 verses he has composed and inscribed on these pillars. The verses have multiple layers of meanings. At one level, it reads like a poem in praise of Lord Shiva, and at another level, it reads like the praise of the king himself. Of the 8 verses, there is one which is very famous because of its irreverent tone and sense of humor. It's called Nadipriya, meaning the lover of rivers, and it goes like this. Kavirim nayanabhirama salilam arama maladharam devo vikshanadipriya priyagunam apyesha rajyediti shashankagiri kanya pitrukulam hitveha manye girau nityam tishtati pallavasya daitam etam bruvana nadim. This is the translation. Kaveri is so beautiful and so pleasing to the eye. She is wearing a garland of gardens and flowing so gracefully. Shiva is Nadipriya, a lover of rivers, and Kaveri has such attractive qualities. Parvati, the daughter of the mountain, is worried that he might fall in love with her. I think that's why she has left her father's abode and residing here permanently on this mountain. She is constantly reminding Shiva that Kaveri is the beloved of the Pallava king. This verse beautifully complements the image of Shiva as Gangadhara and also the breathtaking beauty of Kaveri that flows close to the hill. Shiva is seen capturing Ganga in his matted locks and hence is referred to as the lover of rivers, Nadipriya. There is a beautiful description of Kaveri as a lady wearing a garland of gardens, pleasing to the eye and possessing attractive qualities. You can almost visualize the king Mahendravarman standing on this ancient rock and looking down at Kaveri, curving around the plains, lush with greenery and majestic temples on her banks, and instantly falling in love with her. Incidentally, the word Arama means both garden and temple. So Arama Maladharam has 2 meanings, wearing a garland of gardens or wearing a garland of temples. Parvati is jealous that Shiva may fall in love with her. So she has abandoned her father's home, the mighty Himalayas, and residing here permanently. She's warning Shiva that Kaveri is very dear to the Pallava king. Notice the tone of the poem, as though the king and Shiva are equals. The implication being he would be dissuaded from possessing Kaveri because she is the beloved of the great king Mahendra Varman. The verse also subtly points to the similarity between Shiva and the king. Like Shiva is the lord of the Ganga, Mahendra Varman is the lord of Kaveri, an equally sacred river. While this comparison is only implied in this verse, he states it more explicitly in the end. He concludes the poem by reiterating that he has created this god in his own image and thus made himself immortal too. Throughout the poem, he uses names for Shiva which are also his own epithets or titles, like Gunabhara, Satyasandha, Purushottama, etc. Just to make sure that people don't miss the connection, he has inscribed the entire list of his epithets in the temple to serve as a ready reckoner. He has named the temple Lalitankura Pallaveshwara Griham, which means the temple of the handsome, charming Pallava king. Lalitankura is another title of Mahendra Varman. There is a double meaning in the title itself. It could either mean the temple belonging to the king or the temple for the king. This double meaning is not only seen in the poem, but also in the sculpture itself. Mahendra Varman says that this god is created in his own image. If you take the suggested meaning, Shiva represents Mahendra Varman himself. He's at the center, standing majestically like a god. The four figures around him represent the feudatories of the Pallava dynasty. Some researchers say that the princely figure next to the Ganga represents the western Ganga ruler, and the figure on the right represents the Kadamba ruler, whose emblem is a dog. The animal in the sculpture is not clearly identified. Some believe it is a dog. There is a breathtaking Gangadhara in Kailashanatha temple in Kanchipuram, which is also built by the Pallavas. That one too has a dog in it, and that image too is a puzzle which encodes a mystery. I have spoken about the astronomical information encoded in that Gangadhara sculpture in an earlier post. I have given the link to that post at the end of this one. It is amazing how many layers of meaning this beautiful sculpture and the accompanying poem convey. It has something for every visitor, the devout, the learned, the artist, and the political buff. Also observe how the temple, poem, and the image seamlessly emerges from the landscape. This temple should not be seen as a standalone entity separated from its surroundings. It is part of the surrounding nature. Like Shiva emerges from the rock of the Elephanta caves, this temple too emerges from the rock, the river, and the trees that surround it. A natural consequence of the beauty and divinity that already exists in this place that has only been unveiled by the artists. I want to end here. The entire poem is a thing of beauty. If you wish to know more about the poem and its nuances, there are several researchers who have written and spoken about this poem and this temple. I have shared some of the links in the description below. I have also posted a translation of the entire poem. That's it from me. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and press the bell icon for reminders. Please share it with your friends. Until next time, Namaste.